is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. I have another exciting episode for you today. Today I'm at a place where I'm not often at, and some of you guys, longtime viewers, may know where this place is, and some of you guys may not. This is actually one of my two community garden plots. So before I even converted my front yard over, I was growing my food in the periphery of my yard, and then also here at the community garden to grow more food because I didn't want to take out my lawn yet. But at some point I figured, you know, lawns are a waste. I took it out and grow significantly a lot more food at the house there. But that being said, community garden plots are still very valuable. Although today we're going to cover just a few things that have been going on at my community garden plot. So one of the first things to know at the community garden plot, and even at your home, you may get pilferage. And what is pilferage? That's like when people steal stuff from you. And that's not fun, whether they're stealing the food, the hard-earned food that you planted and grew, or even more so, which we'll talk about in a second. Because this is a non-patrolled community garden, and this is a major thoroughfare for people walking through, cutting between the two cities here, you know, I have had people break in, literally, and this is actually one of the places where they did it. They literally took some kind of bolt cutter to cut a line right down the fence here to literally walk in and steal some of my crops. And at that time, I think I had like peppers and tomatoes growing. So from that experience, I learned that, hey, maybe I shouldn't plant peppers and tomatoes because those are like high profile crops. People know what they are and people love to eat them. So then I started maybe growing things that people wouldn't know and people don't like to eat. And actually we'll show you some of those guys in a second. So whether you're at your house or your community garden, you always have to be aware that, you know, passerbyers may want to take your food. I do have a really good video on, you know, about that, you know, what to do if people are stealing your food. You could put up fences, grow things like rose bushes or lychee tomatoes or stinging nettles that'll get them, you know, when they're trying to get in to steal your crops. But you could also plant things that are less desirable. So actually, before I get into the major item that was pilfered from me here at the community garden, let's go down to my other plot and share with you guys some of the things that I'm now growing to be smarter about growing so that things won't get pilfered. Now we're in my second community garden plot, and this plot is actually a little bit larger than my first one, and I laid it out a little bit better. The first one had like 12-inch wide pathways for walking, and I want to maximize my growing space because the plot wasn't so wide. And that actually is not too wise. I definitely recommend minimum 16 to 24 inches for walking pathways. You know, that's a little bit too narrow, and I may redo that one of these days. But the things that I found that I'm growing that's smart to grow here for a few reasons. Number one are these guys right here. These are actually German stinging nettles. So why are they German stinging nettles compared to just stinging nettles? Well, stinging nettles, as you know, may be a weed to many people, but to me, it's a very important and very nutritious food source. If you go to, say, a health food store, I was just in one the other day, you could buy dried stinging nettles for like $20 a pound. I mean, that's dried stinging nettles, $20 a pound. That's a lot of money. And here it is. They literally grow as a weed. This I have not managed this bed. The only thing I've ever done to this bed is plant some seeds once. They seem to grow year after year without me doing anything. The other thing to do is that, you know, if I wanted to, I could grow them along the fence line, and then, you know, people brushed up against them like I'm brushing now, I just got stung. So, you know, it's temporarily uncomfortable, but really not gonna hurt you. How I like to use these guys is, you know, people commonly make teas and herbal tinctures and, you know, things like that, but actually I like to use these in a blender. I'll actually take and blend these up or juice these up. They're actually quite delicious and actually very nutritious. They're probably one of the most nutrient-dense foods on the planet that most people aren't even eating, and you often don't see these guys in trade because if you do try to harvest these, you know, and ship them, you know, they're going to be wilted and you're not even going to make they're not even going to make it. So you may be able to see these at farmers markets, but they're oftentimes, you know, not looking too fresh. So if you really want them, you got to grow them yourself, or you could also wild harvest them. And that's how I got these seeds. I was actually in Germany in a wild, I took a wild foods walk with a medical doctor over there who uses the seeds of these guys along with flax seeds to help heal people with certain medical conditions. So the seeds are also edible and very nutritious, but so are the leafy greens. So we went to different places and I tasted all the stinging nettles in that area in Germany, and I brought these guys back because these had the largest leaves and actually tasted the sweetest and best. So now I have one whole raised bed of these guys, and these guys are actually in the raised bed where there's a nice plum tree coming out the middle of the bed too. So I could definitely tell you that people are not gonna steal my stinging nettles because they're gonna get stung to heck. Although I did have one of my fellow community gardeners said that, hey John, your sting nettles look so lush and vibrant, can I have some? And you know, I'd probably say, instead of having some of my sting nettles, I'd say, why don't you come and dig some up and transplant them over in your garden so that you'll have bountiful harvests year after year. And I know I may be getting some requests for the seeds, because I have gotten the request for the seeds, because I did have another video on these before and I haven't actually started collecting or saving seeds. But when I do, I will make them available on the website. So besides the stinging nettles, you know, another thing I intend to plant over here are the lychee tomatoes. Maybe I'll plant those around the fencing, around the edges, and that actually has nice thorns like the rose bush, but it also produces edible fruit. But because people don't know what the heck it is, they're probably not gonna eat these little red berries that may be poisonous. They're not, but people don't know, and people tend to be not eating things if they don't know what it is. So that's actually a thing you can use to your advantage. Grow all these uncommon things that people have no clue what they are. Hey, maybe even if you grew green tomatoes, they're not gonna pick them because they're gonna think they're not ripe, even though they are. So the next thing I'm growing, or choosing to grow in my community garden plot, are in these two beds here. And this one is actually called the Chinese artichoke. And let's see if we could actually dig one up here for you. We'll go over here to dig one up. Now the Chinese artichoke is a root crop. And let's see, how about right over here? The Chinese artichoke is a root crop. So, you know, once again, if people don't see it, they're not gonna know what it is. I mean, somebody that knows, that's in the know, might think, oh yeah, this stuff, you know, looks like a mint. And you know, say, hey, yeah, they could harvest my mint. But this is actually in the mint family or related to mint. What is used is a tuber. So I'm carefully digging this guy up right here, and you can see this is still just a baby, and I do have other videos on this, and you can see here what we're looking for is this little tuberous root growth right here. And this is it right here. And these get longer. I've probably had them probably about like that long and fairly fat. And this literally looks like a worm. So this is a nice, you know, joke to fool people. Put it in your salads when they're eating your salad from your homegrown veggies, dig out worms and stuff. They'll be tripping out. And these guys actually taste similar to like maybe a jicama and a Jerusalem artichoke. A nice mild flavor. This one hasn't been watered and a little bit dry. So these guys are really early. You know, these do need to be in the full season and be harvested right before the winter when it gets cold. That's one of the things I'm growing. Another thing I'm growing by default is the borage, and I think they're just reseeding themselves, although I think we're gonna end up pulling all this stuff. I want to remind you guys that the borage, you can just definitely eat the leaves. You know, people think this is a weed because in the community garden, it grows everywhere. But you guys could eat the leaves as a lettuce, although they do have some pricklers. And when you feel it like this, kind of feels like you're petting a porcupine, although it doesn't sting you like the stinging nettles. You could also, you know, juice or blend these guys up. Or if you choose to cook them, they'd probably cook up. I actually like the borage the most for actually the flowers. And also the seeds are edible too. They're high in essential fatty acids. These are the Jerusalem artichokes. And actually, if you did purchase the Jerusalem artichokes for me, I want to thank you. You guys helped me to actually clear out this whole side of my raised bed, because we had all Jerusalem artichokes that we harvested last year to send you guys in this bed. And I'm converting over to grow more of the yacone, another tuberous root crop that doesn't quite grow as prolifically and that I like a little bit more. That being said, the Jerusalem artichokes grow really crazy. They grow great. You'll have tremendous and high yields. You know, just feed them well and keep them watered. This guy looks like he's a little bit underwatered right now. But once again, this is another tuberous root crop that's gonna be growing under the ground so that people won't be stealing it or pilfering it from you. And the final one I'm gonna cover today is this guy right here, and I'm not digging this up. These are my pride and joy. These are actually called the yacone, also called earth apple. So this is another tuberous root crop, and all these three root crops that I'm mentioning, you can't eat raw. There's no reason to cook them whatsoever, although you can. You could just harvest them up, and I like to many times just cut them and slice them into like little chips and dip them in like a guacamole or a salad dressing and just eat them. You could also dice them up, put them on salads. Also, they add a nice texture to juices. That being said, don't juice a lot of Jerusalem artichokes. I had an abundance of Jerusalem artichokes one time, and I juiced like a big tall glass of straight Jerusalem artichoke juice. And you know, it was definitely strong, but the even worse thing than that was that I was on taking an airline flight, and I found myself on the toilet most of the trip. So that's a fun experience that you guys can learn from. So if you're gonna juice it, just juice little bits at a time. Nonetheless, the yacone is actually one of the sweetest root crops that you can grow. They literally taste like a Granny Smith apple. They're actually a little bit sweet if you harvest them and then let them kind of hang out for a little bit. and they're actually really good. So that's what I'm going to be focusing on this year in this garden. In the empty area, we're going to fill it in and grow some more yucon. And then as the understory, we're going to grow the yucon, which grows really tall. And then underneath it, we're going to grow all the Chinese artichokes. As you know, the understory, they seem to grow together well. So that's what we're doing in this area. And guess what? Nobody's going to break in to pilfer any of this stuff because they have no clue what it is. Let's head over to the other garden and show you guys what prompted the video today and what got pilfered from me that upset me a little bit. You can see here, we've got this pretty much cleared out. We got a whole bunch of compost. Unfortunately, they don't have a compost facility on site here, so we send this off to get composted. So we are clearing this. We're going to basically get ready for the new upcoming season. And we're going to re-enrich with rock dust and add more compost and till that in and get it all planted out. But before we do, I have a big issue, and that's actually right over here. So let me show you guys what happened. In my community garden, wherever I grow, I highly encourage everybody to always have an automatic watering system. This makes it so that, you know, it frees you up, creates time in your life to do the other things like go on vacation or, you know, do whatever you want to do and not be tending to your garden. You know, that's something that can easily be automated. Of course, there's other things in gardening, such as, you know, checking for pests and stuff that can't necessarily be automated yet, but maybe one day. Nonetheless, installing an automatic watering system is one of the easy things you can do to make it, you know, basically make your garden. You set it up, set a watering system, and you literally could walk away for a few days or maybe even a week and, you know, be confident that your plants are gonna get water so that they'll still be alive. So this is all set up on an automatic watering system because I'm not at the community garden every day. And it's currently set up on a drip system. But what happened was right here we had the water timer, and then we adapted it to go into the drip hose, and then it goes through actually a filter. I have a standard KDF shower filter here that was filtering out the chlorine, and then it goes into my drip system to water my community garden. But unfortunately, what happened during the winter at some point, somebody literally cut the pipe here and unscrewed it off the threads and took my water timer. I mean, water timers are about $30. And when they did that, they got blasted with water. And I hope they did this in the winter time when it was really cold, because that's probably when they did it. But, and they couldn't turn this off because I took the screw off. So they're getting blasted with water, and I don't know if they just left it running or what happened, but they couldn't really turn it off. So now it's dripping. So I got to get that taken care of. But nonetheless, somebody pilfered my water timer. The only thing I could say that's positive about this experience is that I'm happy they stole my water timer. Now they can water their garden, and now they could go on vacation, but I can't until I replace it. But also, this is a great opportunity for me to upgrade this system because it is right near the pathway. Maybe we're going to move it lower down. Maybe we're going to, you know, put a box around it so that this won't happen again. And maybe this is a good opportunity to change out the standard drip irrigation to what the earth mister. I have been using the earth mister in my raised bed, and you know, for about 3 months now, and it has been working fairly well. Stay tuned for the install video really soon. That's gonna be a big one to edit for me, so it's been taking a while. But you know, that system's working really well, and in a community garden situation, I think it'd be probably one of the best systems you could put in. It's a subsurface irrigation. It could save up to 30% more water than a drip. Also, it can aerate your roots so your plants are going to grow faster. And it's basically a one-time install. Right now, since we are clearing everything, all this drip pipe on the top of the beds tend to get in the way when we're trying to work the soil. And you know, it's not quite as effective as the earth mister system is. So I'm going to try to get that dialed in, get a new water timer, get the earth mister system set up in this community garden, and continue to grow on. The message that I want you guys to take from this episode are a few things. Number one, if you do have a community garden, you know, you do want to be aware that people, unfortunately, you know, may need to eat your food or take your water timer so that they could go on vacation, you know, and there's nothing wrong with that. I feel great that I'm being able to help them out with my food or my water timer. But that being said, I, you know, don't want to be a victim, and I don't want this to happen to me. So I'm going to do things to prevent that, such as growing crops that they're not going to want to take, making it, you know, more difficult for them to pilfer your hoses and water timers. You know, by burying the earth mister system, they're really not going to even see any irrigation in there. So then they're probably going to think, oh, there's nothing to steal, and go to the next plot that does have a water timer that's easier prey. So hopefully with these tips, you'll be able to more effectively grow at your home or community garden so that you can keep and grow all your own food. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and keep on growing.